Mic's on?
Yep. Good afternoon. This is the Board of Standards and Appeals afternoon calendar for July 28, 2015. Zoning calendar, begin with new items. Item number one, 10214 BC, 4017 Avenue P, Brooklyn.
Good afternoon. Moshe Friedman, Friedman PE, representing the synagogue. I'm not going to go, I have a very nice color-coded list of what, but I'm not going to go exactly in order because certain things I believe should go beforehand. First of all, I believe Commissioner Martinez wanted to see the approved plans for the building, which is not a problem because I did them.
Well, you did them. So it's much easier, okay.
Those are scanned copies of the approved plans. There was no extension done at the time.
At the front or anything else.
It was an existing forced family residence. Now, if I can give you a little bit of a background of all these types of buildings. It most probably was built originally as a two-family dwelling. But at one point during World War II, when there was a dearth of housing, that era, the building department fast-tracked a lot of buildings, and this was converted legally into a forced family dwelling. At the time when they converted it into a four-family dwelling, so you couldn't have, they used to take the attic off, leave it vacant. So it was two families on each floor with the attic being vacant. The attic was always there. A four-family dwelling is not permitted in an R32 zone. So it was a non-conforming use. A synagogue is a conforming use. It is a brick building, so therefore it was permitted to convert the non-conforming use to a conforming use, which is a one family and a synagogue, and that's how the original conversion was done. I do believe it may have been Commissioner Hinkson, may have been the borough superintendent, Tom Ferriello gave us at the time some reconsiderations that we needed. I mean, it was, the rabbi will speak to what happened in between all those years, but.
Question about that. So when it was converted to the synagogue, because you did the drawings, right?
Right.
So, how was the structure of the first floor supported?
There was one extra column that was needed. If you look at the cellar floor, there's one column that was put in. The rest of it was deemed to be sufficient.
And just a column, no additional beams?
No. We can get a structural engineer to give a report on the adequacy, but we're leaving that have been there for 10 years. It's fine. They don't have a problem with it, but we'll get a structural engineer's report just to put the adequacy of the existing building.
You didn't add a beam in the cellar running down the center?
We used the existing beam. There was an existing beam, but the distances between the columns was two, so we added one column in there. You see in the cellar there's one column added?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so that was the approved plan. So
that was for the 74 people. Right. So this proposal is to accommodate 150.
But remember, that's because it's going into the extension. It's for the extra space. It's not like you're getting a higher density at that location.
But when everyone comes in, let's say, you know, it's a big event, everyone's coming in at the same time, first it's a crowd, all sort of a point load or a gathered point load at a spot. You can't know where the 150 people are going to stand.
Well, that's why I said we'll get a structural report as to the adequacy. That's not a problem. The proposal is for them to come into the new extension, actually. So that's, it isn't really. And then there was a question, I believe, Commissioner Brown had a question about the 12 square feet per person and the 15 square per person. Mm-hmm. So this is another historical thing in the building part. 12 square feet per person was never actually written in the building code. They didn't know in the building code how to deal with synagogues that had table and chair seating. And it somehow was something that we used over the years. We came to some sort of agreement that we were using 12 square feet per person. The 2008 code actually has finally codified the 15 square feet per person for table and chair unconcentrated seating. So we did the new extension, we're doing it now as per 15 square feet, because that's actually a codified building code thing, even though most places of assembly, synagogues, they only dealt with pews, which is a different seating arrangement. So that's why we changed the system. Okay, so.
So with respect to that, you'll show us a furniture plan.
Yeah, okay, that, you want to have a seating with the table and chairs. Typical Hasidic shuls all have table and chair seating. Mm-hmm. That's the way they've always done it.
Even in the women's mezzanine?
And if needed, on the first floor. That's the other thing. Handicapped accessibility is in a place of assembly. The building code doesn't require it. If you give on the first floor, also the same a portion of what's needed. So I will show it on the new, on the seating plan, where we will have, if needed, a women's section on the first floor in the front.
So it's if you give equivalent accommodations.
Correct. And it's so small, the mezzanine, that it's again, with the second means of egress, I believe somebody explained it. You don't need the second means of egress because it's a mezzanine. Yeah. And it's less than 30% of the floor below, so it's counted together and you only need
Does
one.
Does it depend on the number of people?
No, it has
it's
to do...
Well, the mezzanine doesn't, no.
It doesn't have
75 people.
Right.
Anywhere near it.
It's anywhere near it.
It's 75, I believe, is the second means of egress requirement.
Yeah,
but
that's
what. I had looked at an what occupancy is this?
The well, according to the new code, it's an A2, I think it is. Okay. That's what it's going to be. Everything changes to the 2008,
right.
2014 system.
And I was looking at an F
F1B.
Right, and that is if it's over 49 people, you needed a second means of egress.
Well, how many do we have there?
54.
We might end up making it, if putting in the bathroom will make it smaller, so we won't have that problem. That's the next thing. So, yeah, we didn't bother putting in the bathroom because that is a building department issue, really, but I'll put it in now. And
well, just double check.
Right, I will check. I don't think it's the 40, but I will check it anyway. But according to the 2008 code, I believe it's you have to be in a place of assembly, which is more than 75 and more people. So, it's not a problem.
So why are you using 2008 code as opposed to 2014?
Same thing. For these purposes, it's the same thing. Because I've been saying 2008 code for the past number of years. Mouth is not yet ready to say 2014. Okay, so what's existing, you can see what's on the approved plans. It was the oblong, the regular rectangle building. The extension is only in the back, and I thought it was clear on the plan, because the plan shows whatever is shaded is an extension on the proposed plan.
Oh, you're talking about the proposed, not what you just gave.
Right,
oh.
The existing plan shows you what was there.
Yeah.
And what was approved?
No, I don't think it was confusing about what you were adding. It was. It had more to do with the massing of what you were adding.
Okay.
The question about what was in the side yard had to do with the massing. Like, you're using that in part for a little vestibule. Like, why do you need to fill up that whole side yard for a vestibule?
So
why can't you have the vestibule on the inside?
Okay. Yeah, well, we need a vestibule and because it takes away space. Yeah. A little bit, again, I'm sorry, on a zoning lecture. I'm not saying what is perceived, but according to the law, there is no side yard in the rear yard.
Right, that's true.
Okay, so if you look at the proposed plan, the proposed plot plan, which is page 13, I should have maybe called it out, but there's a gray shaded area.
That it's double shaded, you mean?
Yeah, it's gray. It's not only the shade, the line shading, there's a gray area.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That is the whole side yard waivers. those two little pieces.
Right, because it's after the 30, it's...
Exactly.
Right.
So I'm just, the side yard waivers are not that great, because it's only a little piece. The vestibule was pretty much, we tried making it, we kept, originally was bigger, and we kept on making it smaller and smaller, because we didn't want to go out too much into the, I could try pushing it a little more back, but...
So, you're trying to, so, like, for instance, you have a vestibule on that side, why don't you have a vestibule on the other side? I'm not saying that you should, but I'm just wondering, functionally, why does one side require a vestibule and the other doesn't?
Well, which side doesn't have a vestibule?
So the, oh, sorry. Go into...
The front has a vestibule, the side?
The little side, you go up and you come right into the space.
Well, that's a sort of, right, so that's a sort of, that's not, that's mainly for the women's to go up, so it's you're not, we put in an extra door, that's not an exit.
They're not going in, they're going up to the mezzanine straight up, I see.
And that is considered a, there happens to be a halakhic rule that in a synagogue, you cannot, you should not enter the sanctuary directly. It is modeled after the temple in Jerusalem where there was a vestibule before you entered. So you realize a church, usually you open the doors and you enter directly into the sanctuary, and a synagogue, you're supposed to have a vestibule before you enter. And again, modeled after the temple. A little history.
Mm-hmm. Just wondering if there's a way. Maybe it's because it's like this heavy brick extension of your first floor for the sanctuary space. Maybe if the vestibule could be reduced and, you know, make it lighter, make it
glass,
shorter, make it something or...
It's not... Okay, so this was...
So it's because it's an imposition in the side yard. Maybe there's a way to...
I can
side
put
yard.
More glass, maybe make it glass.
Make it as low as possible.
And make it as low as possible. It pretty... I'll make
what's
it lower
the
than the...
What's the ceiling height of your... Of that... Yeah, what's the ceiling height of the sanctuary?
I will have to check. I don't remember everything by heart.
There
you go. 8'10". We're not talking about really... I can make the vestibule 8 feet, but I can't go lower than that.
Yeah.
I can lower it a couple of inches.
Yeah.
It is not, you should understand that we met with what a local politician after the community board, and this plan has changed. The whole there is no mezzanine on that 8 feet on the right side of the building.
Right, I know.
We took that off. The original, if you look back at your records, the original application to the Board of Standards and Appeal had that in. But when we answered the notice of objection, the notice of comments, we took that off because we had met with a local politician and he recommended we do this.
Well, why don't you like divvy up the reduction instead of taking all the bulk off the north side, take some off
this,
the south
side? I'll be honest with you, this is what he told us to do.
Your building was designed by a politician?
And tell me, yeah, okay, and? I can look at what we can do on the other side, maybe move it a little bit, and we can come in, you know, if I move
you
it.
Have to change the order.
I understand. Right. Let me speak. That I can't answer right now. That I have to talk to my client and see what we can do about it, and we'll try. Again, the mezzanine, the height is not really an issue. The only reason it is an issue is because I don't know why the zoning is written like that. It says up to 23 feet, but one story.
Yeah.
So the truth is, it's questionable if a mezzanine is a story. According to the building code, a mezzanine may... So I had a question, even if I have to say that it isn't, because a mezzanine may not be considered a story. But I wasn't going to come here, go back to the building department, and have them send me back here. So it's questionable altogether if that's a story, and even if that rear yard objection is applicable.
Right. Because as of right, you could have had a 23-foot...
Correct.
...high, one-story, clean, one-story interior.
And a mezzanine is not officially a story.
Yeah, so that's...
So it's like... But it better to be safe than sorry.
So arguably, what you're really talking about is the imposition on the side yards.
And in the back, it's not an imposition on the side yard. It's
just that vestibule.
Just it's pretty much the vestibule. Yeah, it's pretty much the vestibule, which is I really don't see a way without it. Otherwise, you don't have that. We're looking for the school. The programmatic needs are for that square synagogue to have a normal, really square area to set up. Mm-hmm. Okay. The open violation from ECB was only after we filed at the Board of Standards and Appeals. It should be noted that in the 10 years from when this was approved until we filed this application with the board and informed the community board, there were no there are no complaints. If you look at the complaints in the recently there are complaints ever since we filed. There 2005, and the next one is in 2014.
How come you have not received your CLA?
The rabbi will speak to that. Okay. I did the plans. I am not. I can't take a gun to people.
You don't do construction observation.
No.
But you're the engineer of record, right?
Right. And so I get the plans approved.
Oh, okay. And then the final sign off
is done by the contractor officially. He's responsible. I have so many clients who approve plans and never do the project.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'm not hired for construction supervision, right. So I can't.
Right. Okay.
Okay, there are smoke detectors, which you see are on the approved plans. I just didn't put, if you want, I can put them on the board plans if the board would like us to. It's a brick building, so fire alarm and sprinklers were not required. It's a wide street, even according to the new section, Avenue P is a wide street. You don't require a sprinkler.
And even for this kind of a use with an increase in
yes,
occupancy?
Yes, no, it's less than 300. It's not required. The board can do what it feels, but as per code, it's not required.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Okay.
Could you address the use of the deck adjacent to
the were going to use that for Sukkah 1 week of the year.
And then it's going to remain closed.
It's not to be used. Right. There's nobody there, but it's we would like to be able to have a place for a Sukkah that 1 week of the year.
And
that could be put into the resolution, again, saying that it's to remain closed except for Sukkot.
So, sorry, which deck is that one? Oh, that little top of the
mezzanine.
Right. That's where we moved it.
Yeah,
right. We moved.
Does the Sukkot have to be at the same, why does it have to be at the same level as a sanctuary? Why can't it be on
It's not.
The
it's at the one up. There's no other place.
Oh, it's the mezzanine level.
Right.
You couldn't have that be in the same difference in the side yard, maybe? I mean, I don't know, just in terms of, we'll listen to the
If that's what the board wants, we'll close it up entirely.
It has to do with annoyance.
I understand.
Adjoining owners, and that adjoining owner should certainly, if she is here, should speak to that. Okay. So we had some other questions.
Please.
So your statement of facts didn't address the impact of this proposal on adjoining rear yards and on the side yards.
Yes.
And you need to show a map because we can't tell what the relationships are.
Right. So we'll have Ian, we'll hire a consultant and we'll get a report. I know.
Okay. And also you need to discuss the other institutional uses in the
100%. That will be part of that. Really, we're going to try and roll the two of those together.
Okay. And then the other one was you should, in terms of the rear yard study and the side yard study, look at other properties in this study area that might have zero lot line.
Yes, I understand.
We're talking about the character of the neighborhood and whether it has that. Okay, fire alarms. So could you clarify about the in your papers and on your drawings about the sprinklers, fire alarms, and smoke detectors?
Correct.
Okay. And also the distance to the adjoining houses on your plans.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Yeah, I that's all that part of that.
Okay, those were my questions, but I'm just going.
Any other?
It's clear that we still need that. And then, okay, so how's that work then with handicapped access? Since I understand you'll provide equivalence on the first floor for the women's.
Right, and there's a ramp in the front.
How's that work with the mikvah?
The mikvah was approved, that's the way it is. It's on the approved plans over there. I think we got some sort of a waiver at the time. It's a long time ago, but they're on there, it's in there, it's been there for 10 years. It's not something new that we're asking for. It's the same mikvah that's on the approved plans. And to the first, part of the problem, I think, we're getting the CFO is they never completed the ramp in the front. If we put it back, they're on this plan, they'll have to put it in order to get this signed off.
When was this approved, 2004?
2007.
Seven? Oh, okay. Strange that they didn't require accessibility for that. Is there a, I don't know.
It's there, like I said, for over 10 years.
So, and this, you'll show the seating plan?
Yes.
Okay. And then, what else did we want to see? Sorry. We had a lot of submissions from neighbors about, and this is something I think that the synagogue administrators need to speak to, about unattended children playing in the yards, or everywhere actually, on other people's property, and also about parking on other people's property. So we'd like to hear
yes,
how that's
you're gonna hear.
Addressed, and also whether one opportunity might be to have the play area be on the roof of the mezzanine as an opportunity for to discuss anyway.
Well, not on the roof, I spoke to the rabbi and the administration of the synagogue. We may go, that part of the problem was where you saw in the section and on the plans, unexcavated, because we were going back and forth between the two. We may actually go to excavated in order to make a play area for the children. In order, you actually said, up on the roof will be noisy and it will be more disturbing for the neighbors. So I think we're more likely to go for a excavated cellar, which they were trying to avoid originally because of cost. But I think we're going to go with that in order to give a play area so the kids don't have to go outside. And altogether, that's better for everybody involved.
Okay. Do you happen to know whether, I mean, I assume these are little kids, right?
The rabbi will speak to that.
You need to check whether it's okay to have a subterranean little kid play area.
Code is not an issue. But you can have schools. I maybe not to be the best thing,
not
but
the littlest kids though, right?
Not for the little, but you don't. We're not talking,
we're not
about,
talking about kids.
Yeah, you're talking about 6-year-olds.
They're
six, seven, eight.
The ones you can call along with you easily.
Right. Otherwise, then.
Otherwise, they have to stay with
mommy at home. Yes.
Okay. Also, then there was a question about parking because the neighbors complained that everybody was parking in their driveway. What about how to deal with that? And then. And the pedestrian.
Yeah, well, you need a
50 people assembled on the sidewalk at some point. How is that going to be managed?
Okay. Well, okay. Jim, we'll get Jim.
Any other questions? In terms of the pedestrian impact, it was also both the EAS and in your statement of facts, and
we'll
from the administrators about
right.
The pedestrians. Okay.
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 Can I have the rabbi?
Yes, please.
Hello. My name is Rabbi Eichenstein. I'm the rabbi of Congregation Tiferes Avraham. It's an honor to be here. First of all, I'd want to welcome my neighbors, who happen to be wonderful neighbors, before I even begin. And I want to mention that I understand their concerns very strongly. I happen to be a private person myself. And I appreciate someone who likes privacy. But I want to give a little bit of background before I begin. I'm from Chicago, Illinois. I'm born and bred. I ended up in Brooklyn. It's a wonderful city, like we all know, the city of New York. And in 2007, we were actually asked to come to the neighborhood of Marine Park due to the growing Jewish...
Yeah, could you speak up a little, please?
I'm sorry about that.
You can hold that in your hand if you're more comfortable.
Okay, thank you. Due to the growing Jewish neighborhood that we had, I was asked to come together with my wife and children to open up a synagogue. Now, we insisted before we did anything to get approved plans because we didn't want to do anything illegal. So at that time, we asked Mr. Friedman to draw up the plans before we went into it. We consulted with him if this building would be able to be a legal synagogue. And the answer which he gave us was, yes, it could be a legal synagogue. And therefore, we went ahead and bought the property. Happens to be Mr. Joe, our neighbor over here, was very friendly, came out. And the truth of the matter is, until we decided to go ahead and do this whole, the next stage, the next phase of our construction, we've had a very good relationship. Actually, my three-year-old daughter, I think everyone would know the same. She greets each of them by their name. My children all get along very, very well with them. We've had an excellent relationship, and I've heard countless times from Joe that one of the best things that ever happened to him is that the synagogue moved in. That was all before we decided to do the construction. And actually, I was gratified, to say the least, that Mr. Boxer, our other neighbor, by the community board meeting, got up and said that even though a large crowd comes in and out, everyone acts very respectful and fine. Now, are we perfect? We're definitely not perfect. The first thing is I want to apologize about the CFO. It's something that we have to take care of. Part of it, we didn't get the ramp up. That was part of the reason that we didn't go ahead and get the CFO. We are planning on getting the CFO. The building needs a CFO, and obviously it would only be right if we get the CFO. Now, regarding the children playing, throughout the entire week, basically, there aren't any children around. Even on Shabbos, on the Sabbath, the children are basically there from 9 o'clock until like 11 o'clock, or more like from 10 o'clock until 11 o'clock. Now, I understand the concern about the children running around. Part of the reason is that there's no room in the synagogue. It was brought up the idea about making the basement, which is an excellent idea. I'm fully on it. We will take care of that if we get the approval and make children groups over there. I've looked into other synagogues. I have children programs. We're fully on board. Now, just as an afterthought, we actually had a children's group growing on during prayers, which we had to move to a different location, to someone's house, because there wasn't any room around. Now, at the community board meeting, which I was there, I didn't get up to say anything because I saw right away that there were a lot of rumors flying around, a lot of false things going, a lot of misinformation going on. Because everything we've done has been submitted and cleared by the building department. We didn't go to the next stage before we got everything approved. And part of the concern that I heard at the community board meeting was that they were worried about that there would be a 26-foot wall on the side yard. We took that off in the second plans in order to make it a little bit more so we shouldn't have that problem of the high wall in the side yard. We are trying to keep the residential nature of the neighborhood. That's why when you drive by, you see the residential building. It's really in the back that we're going up, and it's going to be in line with the building. Now, the question is, why are we doing this whole this whole plan that we have over here. And the answer is that at the present moment, it's impossible for us to handle everybody. We have a lot of women who come who don't have any seats, and it's reached the point that they don't want to come because there's no room for them. The children have no seats. Our children are getting older. My daughters don't have seats. There's some people sitting over here who have 3 or 4 or 5 daughters, who it's a whole challenge to get them a seat. The time that we're speaking about, where all the action really is not that long of a span. It's only for a few hours every week. On a regular day, there are services in the morning, there are people studying throughout the day, there are services at night. There isn't so much going on in this building. It happens to be very, very quiet. It's a beautiful neighborhood, Marine Park. If there is something wrong, I would be glad to address it and take care of it. We're not here to fight. We're just looking for a little bit more space, and we're looking to address all the problems that might come up.
So kids in the cellar, that sounds like a good idea. How about the issue of the parking that apparently
parking? Thank you for bringing it up. Actually, on the Sabbath, there isn't any issue about parking. If people are parking in other people's driveways, that's totally wrong. It's unforgivable. And I'm fully on board that it's, and I will say it. Mm-hmm. Now, it's a synagogue that there may be 100 or 150 people going through. Obviously, we could speak and try, and we'll do whatever we could to make sure.
You could have, for instance, monitors that stand on the street during those days when people are driving, to organize somehow how the cars are parking?
It might be a little bit difficult because it's not something that's, they come different times. We're open from 5:30 in the morning until 10:30 or 11 o'clock in the morning. I will do whatever I could. I will speak about it in public and bring up this issue. This is the first I'm hearing about actually parking in people's driveways. I could see it happening, but I think most people are respectful about driveways. They may not be so. Driving in Brooklyn as it is not that easy. But I will definitely bring it up.
So what I suggest with respect to that you talk to Mr. Friedman, and maybe you also have an environmental consultant, and maybe you could work out some sort of a plan to address the parking issue.
I will bring it up that those who are able to walk throughout the week should please come. Mm-hmm. But generally, it is a come and go, at least in the morning. We have different prayer times.
People drive on their way before work or something.
All right, so I'll ask them if they could please leave the cars at home and come back, walk back. It's definitely a concern that if I am fully on board with it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other questions? No. Okay, thank you.
I want to thank you for listening to us, hopefully we'll be able to satisfy everybody. And I want to mention again that our neighbors have been wonderful neighbors. It's very special neighbors, and they should be able to continue. We hope that everything will work out in the best way.
Thank you. Okay, so I think we're ready.
Yeah, I'll talk to the environmental consultant. We'll get a traffic study in and together with this, and we'll see what's going on in the neighborhood, and this way we'll have a better idea.
A traffic and a pedestrian.
Right.
Okay.
That's right up Jim's alley. And
okay.
Okay.
Okay, good. So now I'll move to the speaker. So if you'd like to speak on this, please stand on that ramp like 3 at a time. I don't know how many are the speakers actually.
I have about 7 listed.
Seven? Oh, so it's not so many. But please make yourself ready, and each time you come, state your name, please, and you have 3 minutes to speak. So anyone can be first. Someone needs to decide who's first, quickly. Thanks.
Good afternoon. My name is Joan Belen.
Speak into the mic, please.
Yes, ma'am. My name is Joan Belen, and I live at 3920 Avenue P, pretty much kitty corner.
How far are you from this site?
There's about a block.
Okay.
A little less than a block. Marine Park is home to a diverse population of many religions, and this is not a case where a neighborhood is rejecting a group. Quite to the contrary. Although the public has not been kept in the know regarding any approvals or variations or anything like that, when it was changed from a residence to a house of worship, nobody gave them any problems. And as the problems in the neighborhood have occurred, some people have been talking about parking and everything like this, it's not been something we've made formal complaints about. I do want to point off, first of all, that there's no affidavit ownership attached to this application as required by Section 1-09.4 of the Board Rules. And without knowing who the owner of the property actually is, it really is hard to know what's going on here. Neither is there a notarized authorization from whoever the owner is, allowing Mr. Friedman to be the applicant on their behalf. And I will say that I tried to do an accurate search with the Department of Finance, the Office of the City Register, under the name of the congregation, excuse my pronunciation, Tiferes Avraham Zidikoff, and it came out no records found that matched that. However, it did come out that it was owned by Rabbi Eichenstein and Aliyah Eichenstein, and their names appeared, and eventually at some point the congregation's name appeared, but then the last one on the list was Ms. Eichenstein, and I don't know how to read that, but that really brings up a question as to who the owner is, and I think that's a very legitimate concern. And I believe I did a
research. Sorry, we do have an affidavit of ownership, and it is to Mr. Eichenstein.
Okay, well, we did not have anything like that attached to the papers that we were given by the committee board 18.
Well, actually, no, he's the person who affirms its congregation, Tiferes Avraham.
Yeah, and it's an affirmation upon information and belief, but there's no statement as to what the basis for that information and belief is. In the findings of Mr. Friedman, he states pretty much in conclusion that in a neighborhood such as this, where there's a large concentration of families, a comfortable, spacious synagogue will be a much appreciated addition. Well, I believe to that point, it's required by your own rules that before an application is even accepted, they're supposed to have a list of affected property owners and tenants included in the application. Once again, I did not see that in the application that was provided to me when I went to the community board. And that list is extremely important because that's the people who live within a 400-foot radius of the building in question. So that denotes who the public is, the people that whose concerns are supposed to be noted, really.
There is also a list of all of the...
We were not given a copy of that.
Okay,
that was not attached to anything at the community board.
It exists in the records. Actually, your time is up, but it exists in the records. I'm looking at it right now.
Okay.
So if you would like a copy, you could go to the board office. And
could I just say one thing in conclusion? That the applicant wants to increase the size of the building by 77%, and that's by comparing the floor area ratio of the 1.0 that's allowed by the zoning regs to their own FAR of 1.77. So it's reasonable to assume that a 77% increase in the harmful impact to the public is going to follow. And the people that are following me will be telling you about some of the impact that it's had in the neighborhood. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good afternoon. Chairperson Perlmutter and members of the commission. My name is Elise Bohm. I live one block from the shul at 4111 Avenue P. I've lived there for almost 18 years, and I specifically came to this type of neighborhood so that I could enjoy a neighborhood of a suburban character with quiet streets and an atmosphere, a diverse ethnic and religious makeup, generous on-street parking, and don't laugh, so I could have my own private driveway. Well, I have a private driveway now, and now it's become a problem. I frequently have had congregants from the synagogue park blocking my driveway so that I cannot have ingress or egress from my driveway. And when they park blocking my driveway, they're also committing what I consider a serious violation of the law, because there is a fire hydrant next to my driveway. And therefore, that, in my eyes, not only puts myself but my neighbors at risk. If there should be an emergency while that particular driver is in the shul and we can't get a hold of that person. The problem with parking is not just the driveways. The congregants park in the crosswalk blocking handicapped approaches through the cuts in the crosswalk. There, just this morning, I saw a car parked there. Yesterday, one of my neighbors took pictures, and I submitted the pictures of a car parked blocking the handicapped area in the crosswalk when the person was crossing the street to go into the synagogue. You know, we've had a reluctance in the neighborhood to make any complaints, but of course, as the synagogue has grown, so has grown our problems, including, which I don't understand how they can legally do this. Not that long ago, they erected a bonfire in the street, which not only created fire hazards to all of us, but it melted the asphalt on the street. And I noticed today that there's still a very noticeable mark. I took a photograph, and I will forward that photograph to the board. I understand that the city's interest in making sure that people can express their religion freely. But keeping the size of the shul within the parameters of the current zoning laws is not going to prevent anyone from practicing their religion. It may prevent an increase in the number of memberships, but eventually that always has to happen. You can't go on forever adding more members and adding more members. I understand there's about 125, 150 families. Well, you have to multiply that by 4 or 5, because all the families, especially in the Orthodox community, tend to have a lot of children. Continued expansion of the synagogue, not only physically, but the resulting membership expansion, is going to exponentially increase the number of problems we have. I don't know what they can possibly do about parking, but they have a driveway right now. Maybe they can fit 3 cars in the driveway. Everywhere else in the area is where they now park. And this is because they have these extensive hours. It's a constant thing throughout the day. I do not want to be blocked into my driveway. I don't want my hydrant to be blocked. I don't want to see people parking at crosswalks. I don't know how the rabbi is going to deal with that problem, but that's only one, and maybe parking sounds like a relatively minor problem, but it isn't. I once couldn't get to help my mother, my 92-year-old mother, who was suddenly ill. I couldn't get out of my driveway to drive to her for well over an hour because I had to wait for someone to come back to take their car out of my driveway. Thank you very much. I hope that you do not grant any variance. I believe that the shul can exist very healthily within the parameters of the current building code, and no variance is needed. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
I'm Joseph Zielinski. I live right next door, 4023 Avenue P, on a corner. I did tell a rabbi that I enjoyed his when he came in to live here, because I know what I had at tenant for tenants. But I went down to the building department last Monday, and they told me that's only a two-family house. They don't have a CO for a synagogue. They don't have a CO for the baths they got in the basement, right? They don't have a CO for digging out the dirt to make the ceiling higher, right? They also have the children playing all around. My tenant complained to me several times. I told the rabbi that my tenant complained. The tenant was coming out, and I said to the rabbi, you want to talk to her? No, I don't want to talk to her. All right? So she complained, and there's too many people around. The kids are ruining my property. They sit on my windowsill and break my screen. Somebody puts paint over all my walls while they were painting. The rabbi says, I don't know who did it, but his child took the gallon can of paint out of his garage and opened up the can, and that lucky thing I happened to be there, and I says, close that can up before it spills all over the garage, all over the floor, right? There's too many cars parking. They could only park two cars in the driveway. Now they say they want to build, and now they're talking about children, so that I got to dig down, right? They told me they wouldn't dig down, and they're not going 25 feet high. I gave you pictures of what my house looks like and what they're trying to do. Right? I got 20 names of a petition, but this Marine Park Association is going to send another 130 names to you.
I'll show the smaller pictures of
Okay, thank you.
And I wrote what I had to say when I sent it to you. Notarized.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next speaker, please.
Thank you, Chairperson and Commissioners of the Board. My name is Beth Lodow. I live at 4011 Avenue P, next door to the synagogue. I oppose this requested variance. You have a letter of opposition from the Marine Park Civic Association that Joe just mentioned. Every day there are men attending the synagogue from early in the morning through late at night. They stand outside our home, in our driveway, and talk loudly to each other and on their cell phones. This is throughout the day. Very early, throughout the day, many minions all day long, well into the night, every single weekday. They smoke outside our home and leave their cigarette butts on our lawn. No one from the synagogue ever comes by to pick up after the men. On Shabbos and on holidays, the men bring their children. There are meals eaten at the shul and candy given to the kids. Candy wrappers, plates, and cups are left in our driveway, in front of our house, and on our lawn. They're never cleaned up afterwards. It would be common courtesy for them to come and fix the mess that has spilled over into our space, but they never do. The children who come to the shul often play outside. They arrive on Friday night or on holiday nights and play late into the night. They come again on Saturday morning and again on Saturday night, late into the night. Some holidays they stay very late. They play loudly and without regard to the neighbors. The kids outside are always unattended. No adults come outside to supervise them. The children sit on our porch. They play chasing games around our house. They hang out in our garden. They torment my cat through our windows. There is never an adult I can appeal to for help controlling the children, to keep them from trespassing, damaging my property, or scaring my poor cat. And I really can't enter the shul to talk to anybody because I have to go in the back entrance as a woman. I know the children do the same thing to Joe Zielinski's property. They walk into the garden areas that are behind low brick walls on both of our properties. We can only talk to the children about their behavior because there aren't any adults around to talk to. It doesn't seem the children are told to be quiet and respectful of the neighbors or our property. I worry about what it will be like if there are twice the number of unsupervised children. Right now, they can play in the backyard area of the shul. If the proposed expansion is built, there will be no backyard. They will have only our driveway and the sidewalk to play in. The shul is already here without having a certificate of occupancy as a house of worship. No C of O has been received by the owners to change the building from a home to a synagogue. The proposed expansion will create a building that is very out of character with the neighborhood, which consists of small one and two family homes set back from their property lines. No other building in the neighborhood has the windowless walls 25 feet high right against the property lines that this proposed building would have. Just to rebut something that the engineer said, there were definitely beams added to support the upstairs when they did. There's been three times that they've changed the building. One of the times there were beams brought in that support the upstairs expansion. So that was, as far as I understand it, a lie that the engineer said, that there were no beams added. And also, I think that Joe Joe Zielinski didn't say something about how he has always cleaned up after the synagogue. They don't really handle their garbage very well. They're massive piles of garbage, which would be increased by more people coming to the synagogue, and they don't handle it themselves. He has always helped them in cleaning up the sidewalk in front of their and street in front of their building as well, which is required in our neighborhood since there's no alternate side parking. You have to clean up your own sidewalk. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Next speaker, please.
Yes, my name is Rosemary Guido. Every time I'm in Joe's house, they come in the driveways that's there, and at 5 in the morning they start. The bright lights from the car and the beeping of the beeper, and also they're smoking and they're talking on the cell phone constantly. And they wake me up at 5 o'clock in the morning. This goes on all day long. As far as the building is concerned, I don't feel that it should have even been there in the first place as a synagogue in between two private homes. For me, that's unreal. It would be as if a church was in between two private homes. I don't go for that. I think it's a lot of people around in order for us to have our privacy, that their privacy and our privacy. I guess that's about it. As far as the building is concerned, if they go any higher than what it is, it's going to block our sunlight from our windows, from the back, and it's going to take our breezeway away, which we get air from.
What breezeway?
There's a breezeway that goes in between our Joe's garage and the house. There's a breezeway there, and there's windows in back of that house. So we always get a breeze from there. And if they have this building, it's going to take the sunlight away from our bedrooms, our kitchen, and also from the breezeway. It's going to take that space away. Okay, I think that's about all I have to say. Thank you.
Next speaker, please.
Chairperson Marjorie Perlmutter, sorry, and commissioners of the board. I'm the neighbor on the other side.
What's your name?
Mike Boxer, Michael Boxer, 4011 Avenue P, the west side of the west of the synagogue, but adjacent. My driveway is right alongside the synagogue. Often gets confused. People don't even recognize my driveway often as my driveway. By delivery people, it's often presumed to be the synagogue's driveway because there's three doors. There's a vestibule on the west side with two doors, and also it leads to the back of the synagogue, and everyone seems to go along that side, presuming that it's the synagogue's. My wife wrote something for me about a particular incident when there was a month or two ago. There was a celebration on the block at night. The road was blocked off by police. There was no notice given to the neighbors that this would be done. We weren't told to move our cars. There was a bonfire, a large bonfire, lit in the middle of the street right in front of my house. Right in the middle of the street. Doesn't really matter whether it's my house or someone else's house, but it was in front of my house. But my car was there. The fire was very large, and you know, just some scrap wood, and it was it was a bit out of control. We have very large trees that overhang, and people were saying that it was nipping the trees. There were loudspeakers and very, very loud music that went on for a couple of hours. There was no advance warning or invitation for anyone to attend. I wasn't looking to be invited, but a warning may have been nice. The cell, it was blocked off. It was blocked off all of a sudden. There weren't even more than 20 or 30 people in the entire street. It seemed like a very dangerous situation. I mean, if a fire in the middle of the street, if an ambulance had to get there, how do they get there? It was just disturbing, that one incident. By the next morning, we saw the brand. I think they asphalted the street just the previous year, and it was deep ruts from the melted asphalt. And I went out and cleaned up hundreds of nails, because they were using scrap construction debris, basically, instead of dumping it. It was burnt. Because we don't have alternate side of the street parking, and because people that live in single family, double family, detached houses without alternate side of the street parking, when you're an individual owner, most people are pretty respectful of the public space, and we try and clean up. So I ended up cleaning up hundreds and hundreds of nails. I know there were people cleaning up that night. I saw people cleaning up that night, but it was the concept of dropping nails throughout the street was just a little indicative of who is our neighbor. It's not an individual. I'm out there shoveling the snow, taking care of things, and my neighbor is shoveling the snow and putting it into my driveway alongside, because they have their vestibule, their entry, and that's basically their only property. So they just moved their snow over to mine. I've used their front yard and put some of my snow and some of theirs. It's hard to tell the difference. It all snow looks alike. So I try and move it. That was just a little disturbing, coming, trying to recover from shoulder surgery and cleaning a 100-foot driveway that people had just shoved, pushed their snow onto.
If you could wrap up, would appreciate.
Yeah, that's basically it. It's just hard to live next to a place where hundreds of people go in and out from prior to 5 in the morning to after midnight. I walked over to Joe's side, where the vestibule is supposed to be, and Joe didn't say this, but Joe's main entrance is on the side of the house. Joe has 2 feet of clearance. If they put that vestibule up, he's got less than 2 feet to open up his main door that he uses. I can't read plans, but I saw that. This vestibule, this thing, is going forward of the rear of the building over 20 feet. Joe's entrance is about 10 feet from the back of their present building. He is cut off.
We'll take a look.
It's going to be horrible for me just losing my open backyard, having this wall. Maybe I'll take up handball again. I don't know. Just get used to the city concept. But we moved in. We bought this house February 2007. We didn't know there was going to be a synagogue over there. And we've gotten along well, but doubling the capacity and reducing the driveway, not the capacity for 3 cars, is diminished when you put in a vestibule. It seems like there's more appropriate places.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Next speaker, please. Please respect the 3 minutes.
Good afternoon. My name is Ariel Belen. I live at 3920 Avenue P, about 250 to 300 feet away from the synagogue. I am an attorney. I am representing myself under the guidelines. An attorney or counsel representing someone is allowed more time. Madam Chairperson, if you would grant me a little more time, I'd respect it, but if not, that's fine. I'm okay with the restriction.
Are you representing a lot of people?
Myself and my wife, Joan. I'm not representing my neighbors here, but I certainly have in agreement with them.
Right.
But I am a lawyer.
The neighbor behind the synagogue was unable to...
We can't have you...
No, no, you know, just...
Okay, please...
I'll be very quick. Listen, to begin with, there's no certificate of occupancy, right? There's no CFO. How does that work?
We know that.
Shoulda, woulda, coulda, I'm going to do it. Great. No CFO. The steel beams were there. I don't know what this engineer from Monsey is telling you. There are steel beams that were erected. When the property was bought, clearly with the intention of expanding forever. I sold a co-op in Windsor Terrace in 1999 with my two little kids. Had I stayed there, you know, God knows what it'd be worth. But my son's autistic. He's 21 years old now. He used to think it was cute to run away from us in Prospect Park, right? Chase me. But he's 21, he's like a middle linebacker. It's not cute anymore. One of the reasons we chose this property was the zoning that allowed for on-street, unlimited parking without alternate side restrictions, right? When the synagogue came, I never complained. Individually, some of these people can be lovely. As a whole, it's been a disaster. When I come home from work, when I leave in the morning, when I try to get my son in my house, there's no parking. I got to go for blocks now. Now, who are these folks? They're telling you they need to expand because they need to walk on Shabbos to the shul, right? They also tell you that it's going to expand exponentially to at least twice the size of the people who are there. We know from the rabbi himself that beginning from 5:30 to 10:30 at night, there are constant minions, which means at least 10 people coming in to form a minion. It's at least 120 people a day. These folks aren't walking there. These folks are driving there from all parts. Some of them might walk. The vast majority drive. And when they drive in a neighborhood that was never intended for this use, what do? They park wherever and whenever they can. They block my driveway. They block the street corners. They've run roughshod over these poor people. Their children are completely unattended, right? They build a bonfire two stories high. By what machinations they got the precinct to send the community police officers to cordon off that block, I don't know. Right? That's a conversation I need to have with the commanding officer so it doesn't happen again. In fact, it was two stories high without notice. Anybody parked on that street, if the ashes fell on your car, oh, it's okay. It's too bad. Why? Because we want to dance and play loud music, loud as we can do. The next morning, do they clean up? No. All right? If I sound a little animated, it's because it's incredible to me that this proceeding, which seemingly is by law, even though there seems to be a ton of irregularities, to expand the use, right, for which, you know, any expansion would only aggravate exponentially the problems we currently have, is actually occurring. If anything, it should be a proceeding to remove this. We live two blocks away from Flatbush Avenue, major commercial thoroughfare. Constantly, there are open lots there, right, for lease, for sale, whatever. What's to prevent these folks, instead of spending this money, expanding this thing, sell the building, take the money, take all this other money, go buy a place on Flatbush, plenty of parking over there. The cops will probably let you double park over there because they do that for congregations, Protestant, Jewish, whatever. You don't have to do like other people do and build parking. Go on Flatbush Avenue. Don't continue to ruin what was once a quiet residential neighborhood by completely disregarding anybody and everybody who isn't part of your group. That's really as much as I want to say. You know, the anxiety, the grief, to have your driveway periodically blocked when you have an autistic son, and because they've decided, well, we're just going to take over here. We don't care about you. We'll park every spot that's open. I can't get my son in and out. If I brought my son here right now, he's almost 6 foot tall, okay? Sometimes he doesn't want to get out of the car. It's really restricted my life. And it's destroyed these people's lives. I don't see this under any legal algorithm, a cost-benefit analysis. This is a public harm these people have created, a public danger. And their wish to expand, well, that's all power to them, you know? But go do it in a place that can hold such a use. Don't do it in the middle of a beautiful residential neighborhood. If you have no questions, I'm done. Thank you.
Next speaker, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Israel Nablock. I live 4009 Avenue P, which is two houses away from the shul. Thank you for the opportunity to letting me speak today. I just want to address two things, the noise and the parking. I live two houses away. I have a driveway that I park my vehicle. And I can say my driveway was blocked twice in 10 years. Once it was by a school bus that got stuck. It was very frustrating. They had to wait for a tow truck to get out, and it took at least an hour. The other time it was blocked on a Friday afternoon by somebody from not from the neighborhood who said, oh, I saw no cars in the driveway, so I figured I could block it. In all my years that I've been there, I've never had anybody from the shul block my driveway. I've never had to call anybody from the shul. And if I was asked to park in my driveway, it was always okay. I have no problem with anybody parking in my driveway. And I've never had an issue with that. As a matter of fact, I was by the doctor on Friday, a doctor on Flatbush Avenue, Dr. Carlton. And we were talking about things in the neighborhood. And he said, oh yeah, I park right on your block. I said, Dr. Carlton, why do you park on my block? He says, oh, because there's plenty of parking over there. I said, really? He says, yeah. I said, you can always park in my driveway if you need to. He says, no. It's always the middle of the day. I've never had a problem with parking. Regarding the noise, I work as a paramedic, and I work overnights. So my morning hours are usually reserved for sleep. I come home, I get into bed, and I've not once been woken up by people talking on a cell phone. I don't know, maybe I'm a deep sleeper, but I have not never had this issue. So thank you for giving me the opportunity. Have a good day.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Hi, my name is Judah Lieberman. I wanted to thank you for giving us the opportunity to make the application as well as the opportunity to be heard. It's interesting that when we come out to an event such as this, we hear different different viewpoints and different perspectives from people, things that don't necessarily need to be aired in front of the community board or this board or this particular body, but could be aired directly to the rabbi administration of the synagogue and perhaps resolved otherwise, because I know the rabbi, since he opened his doors, and not only is he an effective listener, he is an effective leader, and his constituency does listen to what he has to say. They just need to be made aware of these issues. Just as there were many people in the room today that were not aware of the issues, there are many people in the administration of the synagogue who I'm certain, till the moment they heard it today, were not aware of it. And this communication is great and should be fostered in the private sector. And on the matter of perspectives, I just wanted to say that the attorney who spoke a few people earlier made a very good point. He moved into a quiet neighborhood, which he believes is being, I'm not quoting, so please don't be ruined or degraded by the presence of the synagogue, the lack of parking, et cetera, et cetera. From my perspective, the synagogue is what makes life in Marine Park what it is for the Jewish community. Its hours are open. It's open all day to serve whoever needs to be served. It provides community outreach programs to the whole neighborhood, keeps our children off the street, and provides and fosters a positive environment for not just the adults, the children, and anybody else who has an interest in partaking in it. And therefore, whatever consideration will be given towards their application, towards them allowing to continue in their growth and their work, which has shown quality produce, should please be considered. I thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Seth Kranz. Although I do not live in the Marine Park area, I was a former administrator at the Committee on Special Education, Region 6, which is on Flatlands Avenue, a few blocks away from the synagogue. I have been a proud member of the synagogue for the last 8 years. It has many services. It's a very quiet environment. It has proven improvement the quality of life in the area from what I've seen. For the entire community, everyone is very respectful. There's a lot of education going on, and from my perspective as an educator, it surely is on the right road. I have never noticed anyone ever blocking any driveways. I used to drive every afternoon for the afternoon services from the CSC to the synagogue, and never was there a problem of anyone blocking anyone's driveway, so I'm not a witness to that at all. The crosswalks have not been blocked at all. In fact, the property next door was kept in very great respect. I used to see Mr. Joe quite often. We had a very short, nice little conversation. We had a very nice relationship. I don't know what changed. There are plenty of situations, celebrations that have been done in many different synagogues across the borough of Brooklyn. Everyone has been given permission to do this. It's not only for this synagogue. Also, as far as I'm concerned, I never seen any garbage outside the synagogue at all. It's always been clean from the beginning of the time that I've been coming there. Parking has not been an issue for me. If I don't find a parking spot on the block, I'll go two, three blocks away. I'll never have a problem. So for me, it's not an issue. I don't know why people are coming up with this kind of issue. And I just want to thank the members for giving us an opportunity for voicing our concerns. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Hello, my name is Ari Freed. I am a congregant of Kahalt Vers Avraham Zilchev. And I'm actually a neighbor as well. I live on 1571 Kimball Street, which I more or less share the backyards with the synagogue. I think my back is almost perpendicular. I moved to the neighborhood about 5 years ago, and I've got to say, one thing I was very impressed with this neighborhood, as opposed to many other areas in the city, it's a very diverse and open community neighborhood, both amongst the Jews and the non-Jews and secular neighbors. I have a neighbor who, I was in law school for 3 years, and I would come home after snowstorms and, you know, thinking I'd have to shovel my walkway, and my neighbor very graciously had just taken a snowblower and done it, which I don't think happens across the city. I've got to say, my neighbors are very respectful, and I believe, me and my wife certainly, and I believe, and the rabbi has spoken to it on countless occasions to respect our neighbors and to try to be considerate, and we all try to be considerate. As the rabbi said, there are times of, unfortunately, yes, we're not perfect. There are things that occur. Regarding some of the neighbors complained about the cigarettes, that has been a problem. But the synagogue has put in garbage cans and things to try to prevent that. It hasn't been perfect, but it's certainly reduced the amount of waste. And regarding the bonfire, the Lag B'Omer celebration, which many of the members of the community complained about, that was done completely legally with permits, and as mentioned, with the police community force there to help protect the people there and the neighbors and the neighborhood. I have to say, one of the people who spoke before said that the music was for 2 hours and it was really loud. I was there and, in fact, helped arrange the music for that evening. Not only did the rabbi specifically ask the musician to please try to keep it at a normal decibel, didn't want to bother the neighbors too much. In fact, he actually asked him to please play the music for a little less than an hour, because he did not want to disturb. It was, you know, it was later in the evening. It was about 9 o'clock. He didn't want to disturb the neighbors for too long. And the music ended shortly before 10. There was every possible consideration for our neighbors, when possible, is taken. This is perhaps one of the most diverse congregations, Orthodox congregations, I would say, and probably even Jewish congregations in New York City. It includes Lithuanians, Hasidim, Sephardim, people from various different backgrounds and communities in the neighborhood. It speaks volumes for the rabbi and his wife, the amount of effort and work they've put into this community, and the amount of people who come to the synagogue, who are drawn to the synagogue. It's a place where there are daily prayers, but there are lectures, there are children's programs. It's more or less, besides for being a synagogue, it's also a community center. And although, generally speaking, except for Sabbath, there isn't really any events going on there, and it is done with our neighbors in mind. I actually practice, one of my areas of practice is real estate law. In our synagogue, we have a problem with real estate. I have been sitting in the same seat for the last 5 years. it's no longer mine. I now share it with four other people. My children, who love to come to synagogue, can't come. More or less, they come in maybe for a minute, and we're crushing to get it in and out. There is, the community has grown, and it's a beautiful community, beautiful synagogue, but we do need this room to, I know some of these people, some of the people who have spoken before have talked about expanding further. It's really not expanding further. It's really dealing with the crowd we have right now. Part of the reason I moved to Marine Park is because of the residential nature of the community. But unlike some of the other people who have spoken, I've got to say, we live two blocks off Flatbush Avenue, less than, I would estimate, about 120 feet away from the synagogue. On the further corner is a large dentist office, which takes up a full lot, about another 100, 120, 130 feet away. There's a tremendous church, which takes up two-thirds of the block. Flatlands Avenue is also not residential. Flatlands Avenue is more or less commercial. This is not like the center of a residential neighborhood. It although we'd like to keep it as residential as possible, but with keeping in mind that this is a community center that's helping the community and adding to the nature.
Thank you.
I'd appreciate if the board would approve the variance.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Levi Eichenstein. I live at 4112 Quentin Road, one block south of the synagogue. I bought my house about 12 years ago before the synagogue was in this neighborhood. And one of the things that it did for me is it brought my family together, it brought community together. We enjoy the time we spend with friends and family. And it wouldn't be possible without the synagogue. But something I wanted to point out about parking. I live one block off of Flatbush Avenue. There are two restaurants, a post office, numerous other restaurants and bars up and down that block. And every day on my block and on Avenue P, you got people that work on Flatbush Avenue that park there for the day because they don't have to feed a meter. So the parking concern, while maybe partly due to the synagogue, has a tremendous amount to do with the businesses and the nature of those businesses on Flatbush Avenue. For instance, every evening that the restaurant one block east of me is open, they have valet parking and they park on the street anywhere they can find a spot. It's there. I mean, parking was an issue on my block. It happens for a couple of hours a day, but it hasn't been tremendously impacted by the synagogue and where it is and how it operates. As far as the neighbors and the kids playing in the driveways, and the shul's got two fantastic neighbors, good, bad, or indifferent, they're fantastic people. The rabbi has on numerous occasions offered to fence in his property so that kids don't have to play on the other properties, and both neighbors have declined it on numerous occasions. I think that if the fence were there, this issue wouldn't be the same. The kids wouldn't be jumping and playing and doing everything that they do or that they allege they do on their property. The other thing is that with the expanded building, there's plenty of room for kids to play inside where it's safe and where issues don't arise. I love this synagogue. It does a lot for my family and I, my friends and I. I certainly do not park illegally. I don't double park. I respect my neighbors. I say good morning to them, good afternoon every time we see them. And I enjoy being their neighbors. And I would love for us to continue to do so. The building itself is also zoned as a four-family house, which as of right is allowed to be converted to a synagogue. There's some mention that this were a two-family house, that this were a one-family house, that the neighborhood doesn't deserve it or that it's not appropriate. But it's there. It's legally allowed to be there. And we're not looking to do something inappropriate. We're looking to do something that keeps with the aesthetics of the neighborhood. And if you look at the renderings from the street, from the curb, it looks like a house. It doesn't look like a massive commercial property that people are suggesting that it may. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Yisrael Brody. I moved into the neighborhood in 2009 at 3806 Flatlands Avenue, and we were sort of testing out the neighborhood to see if we would like it. And one of the main reasons that drew us to remain in the neighborhood was the shul and the goodness that it brings. Around 3 years later, in 2011, we moved to 3911 Avenue P. That's one block away from the shul. We felt that that home, especially with a private driveway, would suit our needs even better. My wife, Dina, and our three children, we enjoy the benefits of the shul. I always walk to shul, of course. The closest spot to the shul is my driveway. So I'd be best suited to walk to shul at all times of the year. The only time that I find my driveway to be blocked is because I have a city group home, which is right next door to me, the corner building. That group home, it has its issues. There's noise from time to time, and they do block my driveway from time to time with the buses pulling in the morning and afternoon. And many of the students and members of the group home will go to various work programs throughout the day. So there are definitely times where there's an inconvenience for the next door buses and vans. But I'm tolerant of it because I understand that there's no use to really complain about it. I'm respectful of the neighbors, and I understand that this group home has its needs, and from time to time I'll be mildly inconvenienced. Professionally, I'm a physical therapist, and I have a geriatric practice, which we serve multiple patients in the Marine Park area. We have actually dozens of patients who live immediately within the vicinity of the shul. And in general, the feedback that I get from my patients is that they're appreciative and grateful that the shul is here, and in general that the Jewish community has taken residence in Marine Park. And one of the main reasons they say that they respond to me in that way is because they understand that the youth of our community and the professionals in our community, we bring a certain aura of peace and a certain aura of respect, which cannot be said for every community, and some communities do not have that advantage. And so, along with growth, in my opinion, comes a positive neighborhood, and the synagogue, in my opinion, is what draws people to this neighborhood, into a neighborhood of peace, and to a neighborhood where we can grow with our beautiful families. With respect to the parking, just in and of itself, as far as I'm concerned, there's always a parking spot in front of my home, which I have a tenant upstairs who always finds a spot, and he doesn't have an issue. I specifically park in my driveway so that there should be more spots on the street. However, from time to time, when I do need to take a spot on the street, I always find a spot. Thank you for your time today.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Hi, my name is Israel Baron, and I'm a real estate manager and developer, and the most important, I'm environmentalist. And today, I really didn't feel good. I had to go to the doctor, but since I heard about this event, I said it's very important I should come and just to participate and show my support. Definitely, I didn't plan to speak. But since our neighbor, Mike, from 4011 Avenue P, stand and said that he really doesn't have nobody to talk to in the shul and to take care of the garbage that the children sometimes throw on the floor, I felt it's important I should raise my opinion. For the last 5 years, since I moved to the neighborhood, I'm the person that's in charge in the shul for the cleaning. I can afford to have somebody, to hire somebody, to hire two, three people to take care of the garbage and everything else. And I decided to be like, I don't know how to say it in English, like Yeshua Ben Nun. It was the opera of Moses that took upon himself to take care of personally the things, not to put it by messenger. And I was speaking to Mike many times about problems, about ideas, about things, about his house, about disappointing his house, about warning him, about the gather of his leader that can freeze before the last, before the sandy storms, and etc., etc. We used to have a lot of small talks, and I really felt connected to him. As an environmentalist, I think this guy, Mike, is a tzaddik, what he says, is a holy guy. This guy, whatever is in his house, he never going to put in the garbage. Even the sleepers or good books, he always going to put it in front of the building. To some strangers, it looks like he makes the street dirty. But having a small conversation with him or know who's Mike, you can understand this guy is doing it for good purpose. He's doing it for not causing bal tashrit. I'm sorry, I don't have the perfect English. Well, not to waste something. If somebody else can enjoy something, let him enjoy it. If not, after 2-3 days, he's going to take it to garbage. But you have to have a good eye to see the good things. So speaking about this, sure like us, for sure sometimes children will create some garbage. But the idea is not to look at the negative side of it. To look at the positive side of it, to say, yeah, we got to work in it. We got to educate them more. We got to make sure who's doing it and to work on things. I don't want to talk a long conversation, long speech about it, especially I don't have the perfect English and I'm not used to speaking in public, but I want to say one thing. When I came to the shul, one thing struck me. Every Shabbos, the Rav gave a speech. Instead of talking about Divrei Torah, about the Bible and stuff like this, most times he speaks about Tikkun HaOlam. Tikkun HaOlam is some idea about how to build yourself, how to make the world better, how to accomplish, how to work on a problem, to see a problem, to challenge it, and to fix it. You go in the morning, you have problems in work, you have problems with your wife. Don't go in the street with your head down, not saying hello to your neighbors. This is Tikkun HaOlam, to make the world better. So I'm sure, even though they mentioned a lot of problems, a lot of challenges that not, I don't agree with all of them, but definitely you have a person who to work with. And Mike knows that he has the right person. When every time there's a celebration and he wants cholent or something, he knows where to come to the shul to pick up the leftover of cholent, which is tasty and enjoy it. And everybody knows that in the neighborhood is address.
Thank you. Okay, are there any other speakers on this? Mr. Friedman? You want to respond to some of the comments?
Yeah, first of all, I would like to give a copy of the, I think he sent it directly, but the councilman sent the letter of support. Okay. I believe he mailed that in and some. With the parking, we will get a traffic study on the neighborhood and a pedestrian study. That we'll see what's going on at that point in time. And if the neighbors want, we could fence in the property, but I believe better than that, I believe that would hurt Mr. Zielinski on the right because he only has 2 feet of his own property and that would make it very hard for him to get in. So instead, I believe the seller will alleviate many of the problems because the kids will be indoors.
Okay, so obviously there are problems. Littering, noise, all of those things. You need to work with your client and come up with some kind of solution to say, you know, hope for the better and everybody's gonna work together, that's not good.
Right.
We need to know specifically what measures are gonna be taken and the administration has to take responsibility for this so that there's always someone to be contacted, that trash is picked up on a daily basis. It's not picked up when you feel like it or when it's best sounds better. It's picked up every day.
100%.
Responsible for your own property and the sidewalk in front. And in terms of the parking, we'll figure out what's going on because we don't know at this moment. And in terms of the parking and pedestrian studies, the engineer who's doing that work or the environmental engineer who's doing that work, they need to coordinate with you about the minion times to make sure
100%.
The daytime, the weekday visits.
Well, we're going to concentrate on the weekday because Shabbos doesn't make a difference. So we're going to concentrate on the weekday minion times and we'll have Jim look at what's going on.
Right.
I feel sorry for Nia. He has the girl that goes out. She's going to have to go there at 5 o'clock in the morning, but we'll try. Azoigaitis, as we say in Yiddish. That's the way it will go.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Also, can you please, when you're looking at the adjoining properties, indicate where the doors and windows are of those adjoining properties, because there was a comment about obstructing one of the accesses?
Well, it should be noted that we specifically made the height the same height as the next, the garage next door on the right. The new portion is the same height as the garage, not higher than that.
But in terms of any potential, because you're coming to the property line, right? Potential
right.
blocking of of doors and windows on that first floor, right?
Right. Well, there's only there's only putting a fence. There's only a 2 foot. I'll put all the dimensions on so you see what's going on.
Right, exactly. So that's part of it. We don't have
okay. So you have to understand what's going on.
Yes, okay. And what else? Anybody else? Comments? Questions? No? Okay. So... Okay.
Again, because of the Yom Tovim,
yeah,
we're going
to
have to get...
We're going to have to take it all the way out to October.
October.
Right? So October... 20th is our next.
October 20th? No. Make it a little bit because I want to. I would like to give a nice submission, and I think if we have a little bit more time.
So here's your choices, October 27th, or because then of Election Day and Veterans Day and all that stuff, November 17th.
Three consultants. The board says November 17th.
Really? Okay. That's good for us. November 17th with a submission on October 28th.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you all for coming.
1 o'clock. It comes back at 1 o'clock.
It does?
No, it doesn't.
No, it doesn't. It comes back
I'm sorry. 10 o'clock. I'm sorry.
But the calendar is posted online, so you can see where it is in the lineup.
In here. Yeah, 10 o'clock. November 17th. Right. And if you want to see, contact Mr. Basilides. He's the project manager.
Yes.
No, it's not. It's Rory.
It's Rory.
You can make submissions, but you can also see the file. You can request to see the file. You have to call the application desk. On the 250 Broadway, 29th floor, you have to make an appointment, though. It's a secured building. And to take a look at the file.
We'd like to continue with the hearing. Please go outside to talk.
I understand. Okay. We have the record. Okay. Thank you. I have to call the next case. Hi. Thank you.
What was the
October 28th.
Please go outside to talk. We're continuing with the hearing.
Yeah. Hi.
Hi.
Gentlemen, please outside. Thank you very much. Have a blessed day. Item number 202, 14 BC, 2268 West 1st Street, Brooklyn.
Good afternoon. Lyra Alvin from the Office of Larry Altman. Give us all a smile, Tony. We can use that. Thank you. We did attend your executive session yesterday and heard your comments. Regarding the discussion of the rear yard, I'd like to submit something in writing on that. I'd also be submitting to you plans with interior dimensions as requested. Regarding the corner in the rear of the property, you are correct. It is for access by a vehicle. And yes, a vehicle does fit there. Of course, we always confirm that prior to filing. The next question was, why are we not doing an attic? And there were actually two reasons, one of which you guys did get yesterday. It is for simplicity. The other reason is cost. When you start taking the roof off and putting an attic on, it actually triggers a sprinkler problem. And the cost of the sprinklers is tremendous. And so in an effort to maintain simplicity and to reduce the potential cost of this, they tried to do an extension on the first two floors and to not touch the attic. I will tell you also, looking at the block from a character standpoint, it actually is better to keep this on the first and second floors.
Okay, so what we need is to understand the planning. That's why I'm asking for the dimensions of...
Absolutely. I understand that, and we're more than happy. And that's why I don't want to address the rear yard issue until we do have those plans with those dimensions. I just don't have them quite yet, as the request came in yesterday morning.
Okay, and please bring the architect with you to discuss this. Okay, the architect is always the expert on program.
I will request that.
Okay, good. Thank you.
I have one question I didn't bring up yesterday.
Oh, yes.
The 19-foot-11 is the rear yard along the property line, and the 20-foot measure
is where the building is located.
Where the building is.
Correct.
And that complies with the definition?
That is correct.
Okay. Is that, it's just, why are you showing that? Right.
Believe me, I had that exact same discussion with the architect prior to filing.
Okay. Because it's on a diagonal.
Exactly right.
Okay.
Okay, and with respect to the architect, if for some reason the architect can't come, let us know because
of course
we
I will.
Want to have the architect there, otherwise we'll adjourn with that.
I understand that.
Okay. Okay, good. I know there are no speakers on this, right? Well, we see the audience. And okay, so unfortunately,
would it be possible to have this? I understand you're filled on the 18th and the 25th. Would it be possible to get this on September 1st?
No. So now that's the thing. Now we're
okay.
Totally blocked up. So now we're up to October 20th.
Would it be possible? I have one other request. Seeing as the last application you have requested, we bring the architect, and this is the same architect. Would it be possible to put them on the same calendar day of 9/22?
No. So that's. Well, unfortunately,
I'm just. I was just trying to. I was trying to
so
get them on since it's the same architect.
On the 20th, it's the only way that we could do it is if they were both on the 20th of October.
You want to do the 22nd?
We certainly are not going to. That client is certainly not going to want to move to the 20th of October.
Okay.
I thought if there was an opportunity to put them both on right. September 22nd.
Yeah. So it's too much for us to handle. No. It's too
much.
It's
too
I know you had said that if there were smaller applications, and this appeared to be a smaller one from my perspective.
What? 20th. Yeah. Right. Sorry, we're like we've been doing so many small ones that now we're at the edge of the small.
Understood, I had to ask.
Okay. All right, so then a submission on the 30th of September.
Continue hearing on 10/20?
Yeah. On, yes, 10/20.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item number 35515BZ, 405 West 55th Street, Manhattan.
Good afternoon. Madam Chair, members of the Commission, I'm Elise Wagner from the firm of Kramer Levin, Neftalis & Frankel. I'm here today on behalf of the Alvin Ailey Dance Foundation, the owner of the building located at the northwest corner of West 55th Street and 9th Avenue. We're here to present an application for a zoning variance to allow the expansion of the building to accommodate Ailey's needs for additional dance studios, classrooms, and offices. I'm joined here today by representatives from Ailey, Robert Battle, the artistic director, Bennett Rink, the executive director, Pam Robinson, the chief operating officer, and Tracy Inman, co-director of the Ailey School, and also the architect Natan Bibliowitz of the firm of You and Bibliowitz. So our first speaker will be Robert Battle, who is the artistic director of Alvin Ailey.
Thank you. Hello. I just want to give you a brief rundown of what happens in that wonderful building on 55th and 9th, and a little bit of how I came to be a part of what happens. And part of that is due to the great work we do in terms of outreach. And I grew up in Miami, Florida. Liberty City is my neighborhood, one of the poorest neighborhoods in the city. And the Ailey Company came there when I was in middle school, and because of their outreach and the stuff we do now, we got a chance to go to the theater and see a mini performance. I saw the mini performance, and now, what, that was middle school, so 2 years later, here I am. But it really does speak to how wonderful this organization is, and now being the head of it, it's I can tell you firsthand, it's an exciting time for the company. You know that it was founded by Alvin Ailey in 1958, brink of the civil rights movement. And to think of that now, we've performed for an estimated 25 million, 71 countries, 6 continents, and counting. The other wonderful things about it is, one, the Ailey School that was founded in 1969. This was a way to do further outreach in terms of teaching young people how to dance. The school has worked so beautifully that 70% of the dancers in the company right now have come through the Ailey School. We have an estimate of about 1,300 students. We offer about 300 scholarships totaling $1 million. We have a professional division which offers a Bachelor of Fine Arts degree in conjunction with Fordham University. We have Certificate in Independent Studies, so as you can see, it's quite vast. And then we have another company, ALE2, which is our junior company. Now that serves a couple of purposes. One, ALE2 is small, so they can go in communities and theaters that the main company can't go to do further outreach. But also, it's a way of furthering the dance education of students from the ALE school, so they have performance opportunities as well. We also have our arts and outreach programs. And that's wonderful because that gives us a chance to really be involved in the communities, to step outside of the buildings and really be a part of where we are. And I won't list all of those things, although I have them all memorized, but I won't bore you with all of that. But just to say that we really are a part of the community in a big way. I think that that's also representative of the building itself, that it is see-through, that it's accessible, that it is glass. And so as people pass by and look in, because of something we started called the ALE Extension, which is real classes for real people, and you all seem like real people, so you could come and take class or fitness classes or what have you. And last year alone, we served about 10,000 people through that program. All of this happens in that building, which gets us to why we need a little more room. And then the other thing that I just wanted to mention is that it's really about the building, but it's about what goes on inside that building. One of the last programs that Alvin ALE implemented was ALE Camp before he died. And ALE Camp is for a summer day camp for underserved young people or at-risk young people. And so we do something in Washington Heights with an ALE Camp. We have nine other ones around the country. But this is really the backbone of the company. And so what goes on in that building is really, I believe, transformative. And so for me, it's personal because I want to make sure the other me's that come to this culture mecca of New York City and have a dream that Alvin ALE American Dance Theater can make that happen. And so we definitely are at a critical point where we need more space as these programs grow to make sure that another person like me will have my job someday. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Bennett Rink. I'm the executive director for the Alvin ALE Dance Foundation. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the building as it currently exists. So as you can see from the slide, we have a corner portion of the building, which is six stories, 55th Street and 9th Avenue, and then a mid-block portion of the building, which is two stories in height. The building was constructed in 2004. We did receive a variance from the Board of Standards and Appeals at the time. Due to budget constraints at that point, we did not actually build the full scope of what was permitted under the variance. So we could have added two more studios onto the mid-block portion, but those were not constructed at that point. Now I'd like to talk about the growth that we have experienced, that Robert alluded to, since we moved in 2004. Really, the school primarily has just grown enormously. As you can see, the professional division has more than doubled in size. The junior division has practically doubled from 550 students to over 1,000 students. The extension, which did not exist when we opened, now serves 10,000 people each year. And just to point out, the extension, while it's a great mission-driven program, is in existence in the building only when the studios are not occupied by the school itself. So when we talk about our need to expand, it's driven primarily by the school's programs. As a result of this growth, we often have overcrowded classes. When the company is here rehearsing, we often have to cancel classes. We have dance-related academics for students that have to be held in studios, which are not obviously suited to academic coursework. And we're also, frankly, concerned that while we have achieved a level of preeminence in the world of dance academies, that the quality of our offerings will begin to be compromised by these overcrowding issues that we are experiencing. So this diagram shows how the building is currently constructed. As I mentioned, we have the corner portion here on the right and then the mid-block portion here on the left. The second, third, and fourth floors in green are office floors, and all of the rest of the floors are studios. So this lovely diagram illustrates how the studios are used on a typical day. This is actually a Monday in October, and it illustrates how the building really is occupied from 8 a.m. in the morning until 10 p.m. at night. Just to explain the color coding, the black, so there's 12 studios, obviously
you
each column.
Take the microphone with you if you want to go.
Sure. Thank you. Each column represents a studio, so we have 12 studios going across. The black indicates where the company rehearses. The blue is for the school, so again, the building is primarily used by the school. And the green shows where the extension classes are taking place. So to show the overcrowding, we've used the red hatch marks to show classes that are over capacity. In other words, they exceed what we believe is the right number of students to have in a given class. The yellow hatch marks show academic classes that are currently held in studios, which should really be in classrooms. And then over here on the far right, we show classes that actually had to be canceled due to lack of space. Okay, next slide. This just shows you what an academic class in a studio looks like. And then just to touch briefly on office space, along with the growth of our student body, we've experienced a significant increase in the number of employees. We are actually over capacity in terms of the number of workspaces that we have, and we've done whatever we can to use space efficiently. That top photo actually shows what was originally meant to be a workroom for the marketing and PR staff, and it's now been converted into essentially five workstations. And even with all of this conversion, we are essentially out of office space, and we have no room to grow. And as we noted in the application, not only would we need additional studio space to accommodate our students, we would need a small amount of additional office space to support the growth of the programs and the expansion of the studios. This diagram illustrates what we are permitted to do as of right, according to the original variance. We could build the two studios on the mid-block portion of the building. But this next diagram will illustrate why those two studios are not sufficient for what we truly need. We still have overcrowding. We still have the red classes that are over capacity. We still have academic classes in classrooms. We don't have room for the curriculum enhancements that we feel are needed to make the school continually competitive in terms of attracting and retaining students of the highest caliber, and we obviously would have no additional office space as well.
What do the black hatch marks mean on that side, on the far right?
So the black marks would be
on the far right.
So this does show that there would be some new classes that would be created that could go into the new studios. So it does alleviate to a certain extent the overcrowding, but it doesn't really allow what we
so
need.
The black hatch marks are meaning those are new classes?
Well, they're either new sections, so they're primarily new sections. In other words, we've reduced some of the overcrowding by creating new sections of classes that previously had too many students in them, so we've split.
So where's the, other than the red hatching, where's the part that says canceled classes or the red hatching is the overcrowding for two of the classes?
So the red would be the overcapacity. The yellow would be classes that are academic classes that still are in studios.
Okay.
And
we were able to restore the canceled classes.
Okay, and what's the blue, whatever, there's a blue, white, a light blue box? The one in the right.
Those are the previously canceled. I can read it from here. Okay. those are the previously canceled.
Those are previously canceled. Oh, I see. Okay. But what that looks like is you have two canceled classes, right? No, two overcrowded classes.
Right.
And two classes, but this is just Monday in October.
Correct. Yes.
And two classes where you're in studios, you should be in class.
Right.
Okay.
Is that to accommodate the present enrollment of the entire school now? So this isn't factoring in, this wouldn't be factoring in any additional growth. This is just to accommodate what you have right now.
That's right.
And then you don't have that much space to put additional people.
Exactly. Exactly.
So you probably should have one that was anticipating growth.
That's a good point.
That would have made the chart clearer.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, because then there'd be a whole lineup of things on the right side saying, sorry, you can't join. Right.
Okay. Thank you. So we spent a lot of time really analyzing what we feel we do need, what we believe we need, and we've determined that to really address the issues, what we require would be four new studios, two new classrooms, and as I mentioned, a modest amount of new office space. This is the last schedule slide, I promise. This will show that same day in October and how the space will be allocated with the addition of four new studios and two classrooms. So we've got four new columns here for studios, and we've got the last two columns, which are for classrooms. So we now have the academics in proper classrooms here on the far right. We have been able to create the new sections as well as some additional curriculum enhancements in these four studios here. And some of the new curricular enhancements that we would be looking at would be partnering courses for dance students, contemporary technique, which is becoming a very popular style of dance that we do not currently offer, strength training for students, and a course in performance techniques. So the four studios would allow for the beginning of that, as well as you can see some additional space to allow for future growth as well. And then this is a diagram showing how those classrooms, offices, and studios would be stacked. So they'd go on the mid-block portion of the building here. The fourth floor would be the office and classroom space. The fifth floor would show the two new studios here, so they'd be aligned with the existing fifth floor studios. And then on the sixth floor, you would have two more studios aligned with the existing sixth floor studios. And I turn it over to Elise.
Can you keep the stacking plan up unless you're going to be using PowerPoint?
I'm actually going to show it again.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So we can talk just a bit about the zoning issues. Thanks, Bennett. So the zoning lot is outlined in red here, and just to portray that the site is a split lot. The eastern portion is an R8 with a C15 overlay, and the mid block, which is where the enlargement is almost entirely, is within a C62 district. So the proposed enlargement would require four zoning waivers: height and setback, lot coverage, floor area, and the maximum number of central office employees. So very briefly, in terms of the waivers, the height and setback waiver is needed because in this area of Clinton, there is a 66-foot height limit. The proposed enlargement would be go up to 97 feet, which is the height of the existing corner portion. So it would be the idea is to align the height with the existing building. So that requires a waiver.
Where's the higher part of the site, on the avenue or on the?
The higher part of the site
on the avenue.
On the avenue.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. It's about a, not quite a 5-foot difference in the slope. In terms of lot coverage, the waiver is sort of obvious. We needed a waiver in the mid-block for the existing building. It's about 67% lot coverage instead of 60%, and we're just extruding the building up, so it's the same waiver. In terms of floor area, there's a need for a modest floor area waiver. It's just under 2,000 square feet under what is permitted. As you know, in Clinton, the permitted floor area is only 4.2 FAR. This would make it about 4.3. So it's a minimal waiver. And the fourth waiver is central office employees. This building is really best characterized as a nonprofit without sleeping accommodations. For that use, the number of people allowed in central office functions is limited to no more than 50 people. Ailey currently employs 76 people who we would consider central office, and they project the need for about 100 maximum in central office. So that's the waiver that would be needed. There's no waiver needed for the amount of space. There's a limit of 25,000 square feet of central office space, and we're well under that. It's just the number of employees. A question was raised at the review session yesterday regarding the location of the existing offices. All of the existing offices, as you could see, do we have the stacking diagram? I guess it's further. If you go to go back to the existing, Abby, yeah. So as you can see, the existing offices are all within the R8, and therefore can only be classified as use group 4 uses. The new offices will be within the C6, so theoretically those could be commercial, but it wouldn't deal with the problem with the existing offices.
Right.
So that's why we need this waiver. So briefly, to cover the five findings, here we're talking about a nonprofit, so there are actually only four findings. The B finding is not relevant. So in terms of the A finding, as you know, we're talking about an institution with a strong educational component, and the A finding is based on a combination of the programmatic needs and the existing site conditions. So looking at the existing building, you have the offices on the second, third, and fourth floors, the studios on all the other floors. And if you look at this, now the complying building, as Bennett explained, the addition of only two studios on the third floor would not relieve the current overcrowding in the studio classes, would not provide classrooms for the academic classes, wouldn't allow the growth in this curriculum, and would not allow for any projected growth in the school. And it would not provide the office space that's needed to facilitate what is going on in this building and off-site. So the proposed enlargement would satisfy the programmatic needs and address those difficulties. And also, the difficulties in a lot of ways are created by the constraints of the existing building, specifically the configuration and height of the floors of the existing building. So what we're doing here is extending the floor plates from the corner portion to the mid-block. That's logically, it's logical both structurally and programmatically, allowing offices to be next to offices and studios to be next to studios, and allowing the studios to be 14 feet in height. If you build two studio floors only without the offices and classroom floors in an effort to better comply with the height and setback regulations, that wouldn't work in terms of the building's existing vertical circulation. In that case, the new fifth floor would be above the height of the existing fifth floor and would not be accessible at all from the existing internal stair and elevators. So you really need the interstitial. Actually, Abby, I think we actually have a diagram all the way at the end. Can you flip to it? No, it's right. I think it's before this. Yeah. So this is what would happen if you only built two studio floors and no offices. That fifth floor would not be accessible by any of the building's vertical circulation. So it just physically does not work to do that.
That would bring down the height to 80 feet or so.
Right. Theoretically, it brings down the height, but even assuming that Ailey didn't need the classrooms and the offices, which it does need, this from a physical and structural point of view just does not work. Mm-hmm. Okay. And as we mentioned, compliance with the height regulations is complicated by the slope of the site. As we said, there's about a 5-foot difference from the west to the east, so that does complicate increase the need for the height waiver. And I think we already have talked briefly about the fact that the split lot also complicates the ability to comply with the use regulations. If the building were entirely within a C6 district, the use could be characterized as a commercial use, and therefore we would not have the central office limitation. To briefly talk about the C finding, the requested waivers would have little impact on the surrounding neighborhood, and particularly to talk about the height and the 66-foot height limit. In actual fact, this is the north side of 55th Street. The proposed enlargement is the second, the Bailey building is the building on the right, and the enlargement is the top three floors of the western portion of the building. If you look at the rest of the buildings on the block, they're already all above 66 feet. And in fact, in this entire area, there are quite a number of buildings, as we described in the application, that exceed the 66-foot height limit. As you know, increased height is permitted pursuant to a city planning special permit based on a finding that additional height permits adequate access to light and air. We did not seek this special permit because of the additional waivers that are needed for floor area and lot coverage. We showed in the shadow analysis in the EAS that there would be no incremental shadow on sunlight-sensitive resources, and we also took a look at the shadows on the adjacent rear yards. There would be some small incremental shadows for a couple of hours in the middle of the day, but adequate light and air would be provided to those adjacent buildings because there is a complying rear yard for this proposed enlargement that we are discussing today. The proposed waiver to allow more than 50 central office employees would not have an impact on the surrounding neighborhood. As you know, the original intent of this restriction was to ensure the community facility uses, which are permitted as of right in residential districts, would not have a high concentration of office employees that could disrupt a residential neighborhood's character. This is not an issue here since the Center for Dance is partially located within a commercial district and both 9th Avenue and West 55th Street are solidly mixed use in character. So we submit that the proposed enlargement is the minimum necessary to afford relief since the 4 new studios, 2 new classrooms, and new office space are needed to accommodate Alvin Ailey's programmatic needs.
Thank you.
That concludes our presentation. We're happy to answer any questions.
Any other questions?
Well, I had a question about the prior approved variance. Besides the 2 new studios, you were also approved for a 7th floor of offices, never constructed.
It was a partial 7th floor. It was very small, and it would only have been sort of support space. It really would not have been, the decision was made, it wouldn't have been particularly functional. I think it was an extra 6 feet in height. And so at this point, now that it hasn't been built, there's really no way to go back and build it. But in any case, the determination was it wasn't particularly useful in any way.
But during the variance process, it was argued that that was needed.
Yes.
And it looks to me that when the prior board issued their, because the difference between the floor area prior approved and this request is only about 2,000 square feet.
Right.
And I think the prior board considered that they didn't want to put the extra bulk in the mid-block. So I'm just thinking, could you give me a little more in terms of an argument of why it's appropriate now?
Well, I think that at that time, and actually Bennett might want to address this, Alvin Ailey had never had its own building. It was in rented space about 15 blocks north, and they were trying to imagine what they would need in their new building. And I actually think that they did a pretty good job of, you know, figuring it out. And when they first moved in, the building functioned beautifully. But They're victims of their own success to some extent, and particularly the increase in the educational programs was not foreseen at, because I worked on the original variant, so it was not foreseen at that time. And really now they're trying to project what they need to adequately address their existing overcrowding and modest growth, things that really could not be, have been foreseen in 2002.
And that seventh floor was just called support space.
Yeah.
It wasn't office.
No, it was not office. It was really it was support and maybe cost, you know, the sort of really back of house type of space.
And then the other question I had was about the adjacent building on the area study. It's listed as a six-story garage. It's all garage?
It is. The whole building is a parking garage, rapid park parking.
Okay.
Yeah. That's what it is.
Condos, yeah. Okay. All right. Did you have any other questions? Are there any speakers on this? Please come. You have, please state your name, and you have 3 minutes.
Okay. Hello. My name is Gabriel Hyman. From the time I began my studies 4 summers ago at the Ailey School's Summer Intensive, I began to notice significant progression as a dancer technically and artistically. Since then, I've had the opportunity to continue my studies through the Ailey Fordham BFA program to apprentice for their junior company, and now I'm a full-time company with Ailey too. And I can most certainly attest that the premier training which the Ailey School gives made my growth success and dance possible. The Ailey School provides or produces incredible artists yearly. Speaking of my classmates, friends, and overcrowded classes are not ideal for study. There were instances where you had to take a class and I was not able to dance to my fullest potential due to the large number of students in the classroom. Being enrolled in a BFA program, there are academic courses that we are required to take, as you saw, that are offered through the Ailey School, such as anatomy or dance history, and these classes obviously require a classroom and opposed to a full dance studio. And it's really difficult to take notes and learn efficiently while sitting in a dance studio floor. Sometimes classes had to be scheduled in a conference room that doesn't nearly seat the amount of students that are registered for the class. The Ailey School would greatly benefit from more dance studios and suitable classroom space, and this would not only give dancers the room required to effectively take class or put students in the appropriate classroom space, but also help the Ailey School to continue to excel with its student body as a whole. With more space, relocation to other dance studios, overcrowded classes, combined, shortened, or canceled classes wouldn't even have to happen, and I undoubtedly believe that the expansion of the Ailey School is necessary when only maintaining even grow the caliber that the school already achieves. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Hi, my name is Anita McDonough. I reside at 333 West 56th Street. And I am here today because I just wanted to make you aware that we were never, my building was never served proper notice about the hearing today. The Park Vendome is 4 buildings, 333 West 56th Street, 353 West 56th Street, 340 West 57th Street, and 350 West 57th Street. And the notice of this hearing was sent to 4 Park Avenue. It wasn't even sent to our building. It was sent to the management office. Now, Kramer Levin represents the Sheffield, which is right next door to the Park Vendome. Kramer Levin represents the Windermere, which is at 57th and 9th. They represent Alvin Ailey. They certainly, this is not the first time that I've spoken. They know how to notify us, yet they decided to send notice to Greenthal at 4 Park Avenue. When we received the notice, it was just 10 days ago. This notice is dated July 6. By the time it finally arrived to our offices, it was on July 16th. That day, the board president was burying his brother, and he was going to be taking a 10 days off, and I was taking a week's vacation. So I never really excuse me, I never really read this notice properly. I should have had some water before I came up here. And I didn't realize that I was supposed to write and notarize and fax it in 5 days prior to this hearing. So I just question how many other people did not receive proper notice. I did not know that this had to be posted. I wasn't able to post it and notify my neighbors. And now I'm going to speak as to why, you know, my considerations with this variance. But I just wanted to impress upon you that we were not served proper notice. And I did speak at the CB4 hearing, and I just find it interesting that, Kramer Levin didn't make an effort to get the notice out to the Park Vendome. It is the Alvin Ailey is a beautiful building, and it certainly enhances the neighborhood. My daughter has taken classes there and has benefited from her experience at Alvin Ailey. However, that is all they do for the neighborhood. They have fabulous programs, but they are, these programs are offered to anybody from, you know, across New York City, across the United States, across the world. There's nothing special that is done just for our community. Yes, the Alvin Ailey is growing in size, and my concern is, will they eventually grow out of the site? And they're enhancing the size of the property, and who can go into that property once it is expanded? The Park Vendome has 10,000 square feet that has been available for purchase. Now, the Park Vendome, this space, was a former health club, and it's at the corner of 56 and 8th. And it's a short block between 56 and 55th. So it's, you know, I don't know how many feet a short block is in New York City, but it's really not far. And they never considered that space for their offices. And had they done their due diligence, they would have come by and, you know, examined that property and considered, would this be something good to do to the neighborhood as opposed to adding on to the size of their property? And the space was formerly a health club. So the chances of getting permission from a health club to a dance studio, whether it be offices or school classrooms, probably would be a very easy transition. The big concern about this variance for me and many at the Park Vendome, and the reason why I think Kramer Levin didn't bother to notify us properly, is that they represent the Windermere. And the Windermere is at 57th and 9th. And the Windermere has already asked the community board that they really need three more floors. And we don't want to see the Windermere add three more floors onto that property. So we feel that if Alvin Ailey gets their additional floors, Kramer Levin is going to say, well, you did it for this client, do it for this client. And that's our major objection. So I thank you very much. And I'm sorry that I couldn't submit proper notice.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Hi. My name is Juliette Amara, and this will be my third year at the Ailey School. During my first 2 years of study, I was enrolled as a student in the school's BFA program. I'm now beginning my first year as an international student in the scholarship program, as well as my first year as an apprentice with Ailey too. The Ailey School is an incredible institution. It's dedicated to spreading dance, diversity, and the message of community. The community outside of the school can actually see into the classes on the first floor. People come and sit outside of the classes all the time from the outside, normal everyday people, and peek in and are inspired by what's happening inside. Throughout the few years that I have been at Ailey, I have experienced many classes where students, young and old, from across the country would come and peek in just to see what the school was all about. The school and teachers are always willing to share. Sharing is what Ailey knows best, even the students and especially the students. We have to share space in the Ailey School with thousands of students. And And when the Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater is in town for rehearsal, we also have to give up an entire floor worth of space. We like to share space, so we don't necessarily mind, but this can cause unusually overcrowded classes while others may be canceled due to a lack of studio space. Even when the companies are not rehearsing at home, the Ailey School is an institution that has so many diverse genres of dance within the building that require different spatial needs, so overcrowding is almost a daily challenge. These problems can easily be fixed by more studio space, providing more class sessions throughout the week during different time slots. I think that classrooms as well would be an incredible addition to the Ailey School. I have taken important courses such as wellness and nutrition that have taught me critical information about health, nourishing my body with the proper foods, taking care of my injuries properly, and taking care of myself psychologically. These classes are so helpful, but can only have about 10 to 15 students at a time out of thousands in the school. And these classes are also held within a really small conference room in the building. This knowledge needs to be available to more students. It's critical knowledge, and having real classrooms in the building throughout the week would be a fantastic way to help transfer that information that a small amount of students are learning about to the larger population of students that the school has, which is growing. I hope these few reasons of many are enough to convince you that the Ailey School would greatly benefit from the addition of more studios and classroom space. Again, my name is Juliette Amara, and I thank you for listening to my testimony.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other speakers?
Good afternoon. First of all, I'd like to say that I'm very honored. My name is Michela Buschetto Viadana, and I'm the mother of Martina, that is a 16 years old student at the Professional Performing Arts School on the West 48th Street in Community Board 4. The PPAS curriculum offers students in grades 6 through 12 the unique opportunity to study the arts in a professional environment, and dance major can study in junior division at the Ailey School. Martina is one of between 19 and 100 dance major who attend academic classes every morning at PPAS from 7:45 to 1:20 p.m. In the afternoon, a school bus take them to the Ailey School, where they attend two classes a day from Monday to Friday, from 1:45 to 4:30. The weekly schedule is supplemented by regular workshop and lecture and dance history, nutrition, anatomy, injury prevention, body conditioning, music for dancer, West African dance, improvisation, career transition, college preparation, and audition practice. Martina has been dancing at Ailey since she was 11 years old, and her involvement at the Ailey changed our life, making us an active members of a magical world of dance. Martina has the opportunity to work with the best teacher and choreographer in the world. Her dream is to become a dancer, and Ailey School is helping her to grow, becoming not just the best artist, but also the best person. If it were not for Ailey's partnership with this wonderful public school in Clinton, Martina would not have the opportunity to study dance at this level of professional training at such amazing facility that is Haley's home. Mr. Haley's desire was to give the chance to anybody to dance. We have the privilege to be part of the Ailey family and strongly support the variance application, which would allow Alvin Ailey to have the necessary space to continue to provide its premier dance instruction and allowed more people the opportunity to be in this amazing and inspiring environment. Thank you very much.
Next speaker.
Hi, my name is Claudia Trott, and I'm a shareholder at 415 West 55th Street. And for context, that is the building just west of the car garage. No disrespect to anything that's been said to date, I want to give you a different perspective, the perspective of someone who lives on that block. Unfortunately, 55th Street is a conduit to the West Side Highway. It is also the street down which the horse-drawn carriages go, for the most part, because they're this, that's the route to the stables at night. So there's already a lot of congestion, parking congestion, et cetera, on the street. Unfortunately, the situation with Alvin Ailey is that with the classes that are going on all day and into the evening, there is a terrible parking situation with folks who are double parked all hours of the day and night. creating huge congestion, and sometimes you'll see cars actually parked on sidewalks, such that residents have to actually walk around into the street to get down the street. So that's one concern we would have, is the exacerbation of that already existing problem. So we think the additional classes, additional employees, additional people parked outside waiting for their kids to complete their classes is gonna exacerbate that problem. That's one. Two is noise issues. Our building, folks in our building complain that they actually hear into the evenings, late sometimes, drums, loud music coming into it, disturbing their peace. And I don't think there's much of a recourse if they dial 311. I don't really know what transpires, but we do hear about that quite a bit as a complaint. Lastly, I'm getting my last point. Noise, traffic, those are the main ones. There's probably some other ones around the edges, but basically, so that would be our concern, that we're already experiencing some difficulties. The last one is a lesser point, but there are a lot of folks that hang around our block, and despite the fact that we have placards outside that say no smoking, there's folks that are kind of on the block, extra people that really don't live on that block and that are out smoking in front of our residences. So it's a little bit of an annoyance. I don't know if it's all attributable to Alvin Ailey, but it's certainly a nuisance on the block. So between the parking, the noise, and the extraneous folks that are kind of standing about, these are things that kind of take away from our quality of life as owners and residents on that block. Thank you for listening.
Are there any other speakers?
Did you want a copy of this, what we have received from frame 11?
I don't know what it is, but you could submit that to Tony over there.
Hi, I'm Sandra Powers. I live at 333 West 56th Street, in the same building as Anita McDonough. I just want to reiterate a couple of things that Anita said. I won't keep you. The notice was not received by our offices in time for people to hear about this hearing. That's why there's nobody here, either in support of Alvin Ailey, which I am in full support of Alvin Ailey. Enjoy their programs. But I don't think that is what this hearing is about, unfortunately. The space that Anita spoke about in our building, she misspoke and said it was on 56th and 8th. It's on 56th and 9th. Okay, so that's one thing that needed to be corrected. And the other thing I did want to mention was my concern that a variance here would lead and give support to the variance that has been requested by the Windermere, which would be a hotel on 57th and 9th.
Not related.
Not related, would have no effect. They wouldn't be able to use that.
Not related.
That's all that's my biggest concern. Otherwise, I support Alvin Ailey.
Thank you. Any other speakers? Yeah, you want to respond to some of the comments?
Well, I would say that the notice was given in accordance with the board's rules and to the addresses that are required to be sent on the board's rules. In terms of having space off-site, Alvin Ailey did look very carefully at whether there were opportunities off-site before proposing this enlargement. There were not any appropriate spaces. And in terms of the Park Fund Dome, there was a discussion at the community board, and Pam Robinson, who's here from Alvin Ailey, did reach out, and her emails were not responded to, but and that was really as due diligence, because it's not a location that we thought would be appropriate for the types of uses that we've been discussing for Alvin Ailey. In terms of noise, Pam can also tell you, if you like, that there were complaints at one time about drums that came to her directly, and they've been very cognizant of that and careful about not having certain types of noise late at night. So if anyone calls, they will speak to Pam or someone else at Alvin Ailey, and they will do their best to deal with the noise. And generally, there have not been any significant complaints about noise, but occasionally the drumming was an issue, and they've tried to address that issue.
So the idea is to avoid that kind of activity the extent you can at night.
Yes.
After some reasonable time.
After certain hours. Would you like Pam to talk about that?
Please.
Sure.
Yeah, thanks.
Please state your name for the record.
Hi, I'm Pam Robinson. I'm the Chief Financial Officer of Alvin Ailey, and I've been with Ailey ever since before we started this building, so I've been lived through construction and I know the building very well. We have had noise complaints throughout the years we've been there from 415 West 55th Street. We discovered after careful investigation it was a certain combination of classes on the mid-block portion of the building that caused the noise. Our schedule is a giant puzzle. You saw it without the class names, but we've, after great difficulty canceling a few things, combining things, have generally managed to move the noisier classes either below grade or to the 9th Avenue side. And I do believe, actually, with this addition, it's going to help our neighbors at 415 because we will have more spaces to choose from. So that's one thing. And then with the Park Vendome, I did actually speak with Anita myself over the phone. We discussed it. We were open to coming to look at the space with our architects, but the individual who needed to show us the space was not available at the time, and we did not hear back. But we tried to investigate all possibilities. Thank you.
Okay. So this noise was not due to open windows?
No, no, the building windows do not open. The architects could clarify this, but I really don't know exactly how the noise travels, but there are aluminum mullions that go through the building. Perhaps they travel through that way. It was a combination of our West African and Afro-Cuban classes on the studios that face the rear corner, and that was the magic combination that unfortunately disturbed our neighbors, so we try to avoid that at all costs.
Mm-hmm. Kit, I don't know if you're the right person, but can you also speak to the parking question and the pedestrian?
Elise, would our traffic consultant like to speak to that?
Sure.
Yeah. Eric, thanks, Pam. Eric Arsamont is here from Sam Schwartz, and he did the EAS, but he also did some informal studies of parking because it was something that we wanted to make sure that we were aware of. So Eric, can you?
Hi, I'm Eric Arsamont with Sam Schwartz Engineering. I'm a senior vice president. So we did, as Elise said, we didn't need to do a study as part of the EAS, but we did an informal study. And so we did observations during the peak times, and we determined peak times as when you'd have the most vehicular activity at the site. And so we worked with Ailey to determine when do you have the most. We actually looked at in between classes. So there's 80-minute classes with a 10-minute interval between classes. So we looked at when classes get out, and then at the same time in that 10-minute interval, you have people showing up to pick up people, and people will be showing up to then drop off. And so we actually looked at a Saturday between 10 and 11, and because the reason we looked at that is that's where you'd have the most children, so you'd have more pickup drop off. We looked at Sunday from 10:30 to 11:30, and then we looked at a weekday from 5:30 to 6:30. So we looked at three peak time frames. What we found is your peak, the peak, we looked at actually double parking. The peak double parking we found, we didn't see anything, and this is actual observations, we were there on these different times. We didn't see any parking on the sidewalk, so I can't speak to that. What we did see is on a Saturday, our peak was four double parked cars at any one time. On a Sunday, five double parked cars. And if you look at with the variance and the percentage increase, that would increase by about one or two peak during the peak. So you could go up to six or seven double parked cars. And there's actually room in front of the site for as many as eight double parked cars. And I'm not saying double parking is a good thing, but just in terms of the space, you'd be able to accommodate the demand for the double parked cars. And on a weekday, there was actually less double parking. Was actually minimal because on either side you have, on either side of 55th Street, both in front of Alvin Ailey and then across the street, there's a no standing loading zone, and that doesn't really get used much by trucks, so the people who are waiting just actually park, they just stand in that area. So the double parking in a weekday was much less. So since the double parking is already happening, if you just project with that variance another one or two parked cars, double parked cars, and the space is there, they're not blocking any additional space. There's space for them to continue to double park. So that double parking, yes, it will still be there, but there's room for that additional need for double parking in that area.
Is there any way to alleviate the double parking?
Well, I know that Alvin Ailey has been working. They put up some signs about it. They've been speaking with parents. You know, there's that need. I don't want to speak on behalf of Alvin Ailey about the different possibilities, but, you know, if there's pickup and drop-off, people, you know, I mean, on the weekday, as I was saying, there's space.
From the point of view of a traffic advisor as opposed to...
Okay, yeah, not speaking for anyone. I think one of the interesting things, and I think it's an opportunity, but it's a DOT issue, it's not an us issue, is that since on the weekday, you get less of that double parking activity because the space is clear and there's actually not that demand, regulations could be changed there to allow for space for people to actually stand during those peak hours and then just switch it back over. Because right now, there is no regulation right there on a weekend. The weekday regulation is to allow for traffic flow because, as was mentioned before, you have the flow to the Henry Hudson Parkway, and that's why there's a weekday regulation. I'm sorry, the weekday is for the loading, but that's why you have congestion going to the site to the Henry Hudson Parkway.
So sorry, slow down. Right.
Sorry, I know I got myself. Let me start over.
Congestion.
What's that?
Does the double parking cause congestion on 55th Street?
Well, it's wide enough that you still have a lane going. So
if there's a lot of cars going to the west, it sounds
right.
Like
so the real issue is the volume of traffic. You have a higher volume of traffic going to the Henry Hudson Parkway on a weekday. So the congestion is not caused by the double parking because while there's a maneuver to double park, or you could just pull up and double park, there's still a lane that goes, so it's never blocked. The real congestion, we've observed this, is when that signal at the next avenue clears, then traffic clears. It's really the congestion of vehicles going to the Henry Hudson Parkway. That's why on the weekend, what I was trying to say, and excuse me for speaking so fast about it, was that on the weekend, you have less volume there, and so that's why you see less congestion, actual overall congestion on 55th Street.
And what was the recommendation you were suggesting?
I'm saying one possibility to actually deal with double parking is since on the weekday you have less double parking because the curbs are cleared by the regulation that exists there. That's a possibility on the weekend. It's just cleared during peak hours if you wanted to alleviate some of the double parking.
Sorry, the weekday has less double parking.
Yes.
Because the regulation is what?
It's a no standing truck loading on both sides of the street. However, trucks are not using it. It's very minimally used by trucks, so that space is there.
Cars are waiting there, and then other cars are double parked.
Correct. Well, but no, on the weekday, the peak we saw was one double parked car.
Oh, so
because the cleared curb space allowed for space for people to wait. On the weekend, since there is no regulation there, people can just park there. Okay. So vehicles are already parked there without someone in the car, and so that's why there's a double parking on the weekend.
Okay, so you're suggesting that during the peak hours on the weekend, perhaps if there was also no standing in that location, that would alleviate the double parking.
Right, because then people who are right now double parking could just pull into that curb space.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And another thing that the city could look at is on the weekday, this is a separate from double parking, is just looking at the signal timing at 10th and 55th. Because what we noticed from observations is just based on that signal timing that was causing some backup. And you know, I guess I don't have to tell everybody, but oftentimes simple signal timing and the way that the streets are synchronized or not synchronized can cause an issue. And so that backup we realized was partially part of that. And so looking at 10th and 55th could actually clear traffic vehicles quicker based on the comment about weekday backup.
So maybe that all those are worth looking into, even though I know it's up to DOT to decide.
Right, it's a city DOT issue.
Yeah.
It's beyond us.
Right, okay. Any other
I have just a question about the fact that you're going to make four new studios, and if the sound was transmitting through the existing studio, don't you have a window wall attenuation to make sure that you're blocking that sound, at least in the new construction?
Well, I think what Pam said, that it was a confluence of factors that caused the noise problem of certain types of classes with the drumming, and that they have not found a way to put those classes in certain parts of the building. There are several studios below grade, and that's that in that way to address the problem. But I believe there also is sound attenuation in this building. I mean, significant sound attenuation that would be part of the new addition as well.
Okay, so maybe you could give us some information.
We will. We will provide that information in writing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. So, with respect to the parking issue, if you could distill what the recommendations are, maybe talk with the client and see whether that's something that you could at least ask DOT about doing. It sounds like a reasonable.
Well, I think request. We'll provide information in writing, and I certainly think we'd be happy to ask DOT. As you know,
right.
We can't
right.
force them to do anything, but certainly we could have Eric perhaps write a letter and speak to them, and that would be, I'm sure we would be happy
that
to do
great.
That.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then the window wall and attenuation information.
Yep.
And, the last thing was about the pedestrians hanging out in the front. Is there some way that the administration makes sure that people don't, you know, I know there's a nice lobby. Is there a way to make sure that people don't disturb neighbors? Like, is there someone who manages the site?
Well, we have.
Yep, come up.
State your name for the record.
Restate your name.
Oh, Bennett Rank, Executive Director for Alvin Ailey. We have 24-hour security. We have video surveillance indoor and outdoor. And I know personally, if someone, for instance, is sleeping on the bench outside, our security comes out and asks them to move along. So we're constantly monitoring who's outside of the building. And
but
if
it's
there's
more about your own participants annoying neighbors because they're, say, hanging out in front of the neighbors.
And maybe smoking, although dancers shouldn't smoke.
Right.
We actually have signs that say there's no smoking permitted outside of our building. So, I think.
It's a common thing where kids get out of school and they hang out in front of the school. Obviously, that seems to be a sort of an issue for the neighbors. So if there's something that you could implement in your school to make sure that everyone knows it's not a place for hanging.
Sure. Yes. Yeah. I mean, we could certainly make that a part of the school's orientation when they, you know, meet with students in the fall, and we can help monitor that as well.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Good. Okay. So, other than those things, are we anything else that we specifically wanted? Okay. So, with respect to window wall attenuation and noise, that's really. I mean, and sorry, and parking.
Yes.
Right. Those were the issues.
We'll provide all that in writing.
Okay. So I don't think I think we could actually close this, no? So for a motion to close.
Chair Perlmutter?
Aye.
Commissioner Montanez?
Aye.
Commissioner Ockley Brown?
Aye.
And, yike, I don't know what to do about the schedule. How much time do you need to?
I think we could do this really in a week or so. It's really, we have all this information.
Can you write a resume? What?
Us.
No, making little noises.
We're fine.
How about August 25th? Does that work? How many did I put on there? I put little things on there. Right. Is that doable?
Yeah, we'll get it done.
Okay, we'll get it done.
One.
Very much of a can-do kind of person. Okay. So if you can submit by August 12th?
Yes.
We can have a decision on the 25th?
Yes. Very good.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
This concludes the public hearing for July 28, 2015. Mic's off.